Welcome, Shepherd's House. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Would you please stand with us as we prepare our hearts to sing together? I'm going to be reading from 1 Peter chapter 1, and this passage just encapsulates what we are here to sing about this morning. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Amen. This morning we're going to sing and celebrate and rejoice in our Savior's triumph over sin and death. Amen. Can we celebrate and rejoice this morning? Clap our hands together.
Nothing but the blood of sin, held captive by my fear, till your mercy showed. Your hand was reaching there, my God, and you came and made a way for me. You made a way for me. My Jesus, gracious Redeemer and friend, there's nothing like your love without it. By the blood of the Lamb, my Jesus, Redeemer. You're coming back again, oh God.
Amen. You may be seated.
He is risen. Amen and amen. What a mighty King we serve, and what a joy it is to get to worship Him with all of you. Happy Easter to you and your family. And if you're new here, my name is Kostya. I just want to give you a warm and loving greeting. We're thrilled that you have woken up on this beautiful day, that the heat has been prayed away for Easter weekend, that the rains have come, and that you're here. We're grateful. I get to serve as the teaching pastor here alongside a faithful team, and if there's anything we can do to serve you, if you're here looking for a home church or you're here just looking for encouragement, both can be had. I want to make you aware of just a few things. Our resource center is available to you. If you're visiting, please take a free gift bag. There's a free book and some resources in there that will encourage you in the Christian faith. A couple of other just brief things. All the ministry information available to you is there in your handout. Groups, events, student ministry, college. We have a couple of key events that are happening very soon. Our women's conference, which is on April 12th and 13th, and then our men's conference, which we're announcing basically today, is September 6th and 7th. Registration has opened, and so if you're interested in registering and you can do that as part of your Easter morning plans, the women's conference is on the left, the information's there, and then the men's conference on the right. I'm pretty excited about it. The King's men, leading like Christ in a world of chaos, we'll get together, brothers, and encourage one another over the course of 2 days. The women's conference has a special discount, I'm told, so if you sign up today, it's cheaper, and the men's conference is going to be awesome. No offense to the women. I'm helping speak at the women's conference, but apparently there's like a smoking meat ministry that's going to be involved with, yeah, amen is right. On that, and so I've just delegated, and there, I don't know if we'll call it the Traeger ministry or what have you, but it's going to be awesome. Sign up for that. As well, if you're looking to come back and you're wondering kind of what we do as a church, we're going through the Bible verse by verse, different books of the Bible. Next week, Pastor Brett will preach Psalm 23, which should be an incredible comfort to you, and then I'm going to take you on a three-week journey through the Trinity, which will be important, and then we'll run about 10 weeks in a row after that in the Beatitudes, back in the Gospel of Matthew where we've been, and would love to have you join us for those. And if you're looking at kind of your summer, we're going to shift to evening while they renovate this gymnasium starting May the 12th, and so if you do come back in a few weeks looking for us on a morning, be sure to check the website. We will have evening services while they renovate the gymnasium at the Tempe campus. All that information will be online. All of it available to you, and our team can help you with anything you need. The last thing I want to let you know is every month we do a Resource Sunday where we give away free books to the congregation. Normally, it's last week, but we wanted to do it on Easter. This is a book that is available to you today for free over at the Resource Center. If you want to pick one up, and if we run out, you can order them online. It's by a friend of mine named Tim Challies. He lost his son, some 20 years old, in 2020. I just had him on the podcast to talk about grief and suffering and loss, but most of all, eternal perspective no matter what you're going through. And so if you're here and you need comfort, encouragement, or just a dose of truth for someone else that you want to minister to, Seasons of Sorrow is available at the Resource Center. Just our way of saying we love you and resourcing you as the church family here. Today, the title of my message is What He is Risen Means for Us. And so I would ask that you turn in your Bibles to the book of Colossians, chapter 1. Perhaps a different angle on Easter than what you're normally used to. Maybe a gospel narrative. Maybe we begin at the tomb or just after the cross, and we work our way to the tomb. Maybe some will work their way through Acts chapter 1 and what happens when Jesus ascends. But I want to take you somewhere today that I think will be really special and very practical for you. If you will, please go ahead and stand. We're going to read Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 to 20. If you're wondering why in the world we're standing, we just do this to give honor and reverence to God's word, believing that as we read this, God is literally speaking to us. Let's read together, we'll pray, and then we'll jump in. Colossians 1, verse 13, "For he rescued us from the domain of darkness And he transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is also head of the body, the church, and he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven. That is God's word to us today. You may be seated, and let's go to him together in prayer. Father, as we walk through these verses, I pray that the cross of Christ and his work would be so clear to us. Not just that he died, not only the scene on Golgotha's hill, but what it means for us as believers. I pray for anyone here who's looking for answers, or maybe somebody here who knows the basics of the Christian faith. They've heard the gospel. They've heard about you. They would even believe that there is a God, but they have been far from you, not in a relationship with you, not enjoying communion with you, and not relishing in the blessings given by you, that today they would experience a renewal, even an awakening, that their heart would come alive with love for you and an awareness that who they are as a Christian, if they would profess to be one, is attached to and flows out of what Christ has done and who he is. Jesus, we honor you today. It is your day. And we want to see you exalted and you magnified. Help us, please, to worship you all the more and to behold the beauty and the power and the wonder and the majesty of you, our King. We pray this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. There was a man who once told of another man who had converted to Christianity. He had left another religion, and he was asked, "Why have you become a Christian?" Some of his friends came and asked him that question, and he answered with kind of a visual. He said, "Well, it's like this. Suppose that you were going down the road, and suddenly the road forked in two directions, and you came to that fork, and you didn't know which way to go, and there at the fork were two men, and each claimed to know which way to go and claimed to be able to tell you which way to go. Now, suppose of the two men, one was dead and one was alive. Which one would you listen to?" The man had converted to Christianity because of all of the gods he had studied, of all the religions he had looked into, and even the one that he had believed in for a time. Only one had a God who was alive. Only one had a God who conquered death and was victorious over it. Only one, and that's Christ. And that's the essence of Christianity and why we celebrate the resurrection. Christ stands apart from all others who claim to know which way to go, because he's the only one who conquered death and can give life. And not just a ticket to heaven, but the abundant life here on earth, with direction and with peace and with hope and with truth in a world gone off the rails. Muhammad cannot do that for you. Buddha cannot do that for you. The pantheon of gods in Hinduism cannot do that for you. Even seemingly religious figures like the Pope seem to change on the whims of culture, trying to appeal to people. False prophets can't seem to get their stories straight. And even on a weekend like this, for those of you that put a lot of stock and a lot of hope in government, you can see that even a president who on one day, on Friday, announces to the world, "We're so excited to be in church, our Christian church, this Good Friday," a day later reminds everyone that March 31st is the International Transgender Visibility Celebration Day. And he didn't just put that today because it was Easter. It is this date, but it happens to land on Easter because Easter floats. But you look at the world today and you are perhaps reminded once again that we don't have a clue what we're doing. We don't have a clue where we're going. We're always moving the goalposts as human beings, but there's only one who stands apart from all of that. And it doesn't matter what man-made religions say. It doesn't matter what self-appointed prophets say. It doesn't matter even what the most powerful man in the world says. The Bible declares three words that transcend all of that. They overcome every pagan idea, every demonic assault, every moment of hopelessness for you, every dark trial that you endure, and every claim to higher knowledge. The three words are very simple. They are, He is risen. And Jesus is the only one whose life and death had those words attached to him. They are massive. They are life-altering. There are implications for you if you've placed your faith in Christ that you need to be reminded of as a believer. And there's implications for you if you've never placed your faith in Jesus Christ and you don't really know if you are a quote-unquote believer in Jesus Christ. And in our text today, the reason I've selected this one is it's Paul's encouragement to a group of Christians that are not unlike us. They're in a church scene that is a little shaky. The church had been established by a man named Epaphras, who's likely the planter. Paul had never met them. He's in prison in Rome. And Epaphras and him are talking, and Paul hears about these Christians in a region called Colossae. And he wants to write to them to encourage them because they are under assault. There are false teachers who are undermining the truth. They are saying very weird things about the deity of Christ, the humanity of Christ, and about the truth and about assurance. And so you could imagine for them, if the resurrection and Jesus and all the truth that they had come to know is maybe not true or maybe not as reliable as they thought, they suddenly would lose assurance, which is attached so often to our joy. For those of you that believe the resurrection is true, without a shadow of a doubt, you wake up this morning and perhaps the first words that come to mind are, He is risen. And maybe your spouse is still asleep, but you long for the, He is risen. He is risen indeed. You can't wait for it. Why? It's the first thought in your mind because you've woken up with assurance. But imagine waking up and not really being sure. Not sure of what today would hold. Not sure of if you're really going to heaven. Not sure of if this God really has everything handled. The church at Colossae and those who would read the letter needed the encouragement in the truth. And so Paul writes and he makes much of Christ and he declares these truths that are all attached to the resurrection. And so what I wanted to do is not just give you a gospel narrative and take you to the tomb, and that's great, and we've done that before and we'll do it again. And I tell you about the angel, and he looks at the women and he says, He's not here. I know you're looking for him. I know you're crying. Wipe your tears. He is risen. And they run and tell the disciples and everyone shares the gospel. Yes and amen. But there's an implication to that that I want you to meditate on this Easter. And the implication is life-changing. It's attached to those words. What do they mean for us? I think today, people say all sorts of things about Jesus. Maybe they say he's a good moral teacher. Maybe they say that he's a loving person and a loving God even, who just wants them to be happy, and so he endorses whatever lifestyle they lead. And yet, for those of us who believe, he's not just another moral teacher and a good teacher. He's not any of those things that the world certainly makes him out to be. He's the one who saved our soul. He's the one who holds the universe in his hands. He's the one who holds the key to life. And maybe you're at that fork in the road, and you've come to it a time or two before, and every time you've ended up on a dead-end road, I want to tell you this morning that Christ is the way to life. He is the way to never have a dead-end road again because he's risen. Those words affirm his identity. They also establish yours, and so I want to give you four things under each of those headings: what you are and your identity in Christ and because of Christ, and then who Christ is and what he's done The first is you are, if you're a believer or if today you'd place your faith in Christ, you are, number one, rescued. You're rescued. That's what He is risen means. It's the assurance that He accomplished the work on the cross. We're not still waiting for it to happen. We're not still waiting for Him to redeem or rescue. We are rescued. Paul begins saying, for He, capital H, Christ, rescued us from the domain of darkness. And I want you to really, really get this. If the angel would have never said, He is not here, He is risen, then Paul could have never written anything about believers being rescued. It's attached to the fact that he overcame the grave. And the picture here that he uses is to be delivered from danger. That's what the original word means when he talks about rescue. The implication is there was danger and he rescued you. It's the picture of Christ rescuing sinners and the certainty of hell as their destination and pulling them out and away from that. And all of that is the result of sin. But there's another key word here, and it's the word domain. It's the Greek word exousia. It means power and authority. And that is an incredible moment when you come to understand, I wasn't just kind of neutral in my sin. I was actually under the authority of Satan himself. I don't know if you ever have thought about that. We don't like that kind of word picture because then we start really seeing the weight of it. We think, well, no, I was never kind of owned by the devil. How dare you say that? I didn't feel demon-possessed. I don't feel like I was hanging out with the devil. I was actually a pretty good person. Oh, no. We've got to get a real revelation from the Word of God. And Paul gives us that and he gives the church that so that they are so enamored by salvation, and they're so in awe of salvation. Why? Because they realize just how dark it was. You weren't neutral, friend. You were under the exousia, the power of, look at it there, the domain of darkness. That's not neutral. You might have thought you were good. That potentially is the greatest lie of all, that Satan would make not good people think they are what? Good. Not that bad. You know, sort of a medium on the scale. Paul uses the same word in Ephesians 6 to talk about spiritual warfare. Why? It's the control of Satan over something or someone. And in your case and in mine, we were slaves, literally in chains to our sin, in bondage. And no matter how good you and I thought we were, perhaps the most shocking moment of all would have been that moment when we come to the end and we are ushered into hell and away from the presence of God and we're thinking, I was a good person. And we would come to find that being a good person is not good enough. There's only one who was good enough, and God's not looking for your works and for you to impress him with how good of a person you were. He's looking for faith in his son. That's what he's interested in, and that's what rescues us. Jesus did that. And he didn't just rescue us, he relocated us. So there's kind of one aspect to this. Well, you got pulled out. Okay, good. Woo. All right. You've been pulled out of the raging rapids going off the waterfall into damnation, and you're like, okay, I'm on the shore. No, I got better news for you. He also, second, transferred. So you are transferred. Look at it there. Transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved son. Would you get that there's a change of ownership now? Do you see that? You were owned by darkness, owned by the enemy, and now God owns you. You've switched your country of origin. You've got a new passport. You've got a new citizenship. You no longer belong to the kingdom of darkness under the exousia power of Satan. But now, you're under the power of Christ. You're under a new authority. And he's so good like that, not just to pull us out of sin, but to put us into his kingdom. And he does something when you're under his authority. He protects you. He keeps you. He blesses you. He cares for you. I think sometimes people don't like the idea of authority, but imagine how secure and joyful you are under the right kind of authority. Imagine how children feel when a father is in the picture. I mean, they've done studies galore on this. You don't even have to be a Christian or believe the Bible is true, and they've done studies that the presence of a father nurturing, protecting, providing. Some of the feminists don't like that. Too bad. The stats prove you wrong, and those people don't like the Bible either, just like you. And so the non-Christian people say, sorry, my fellow unbelievers who are feminists, but the stats show fathers are a powerful tool in the confidence-building mechanism with children. Why? They give security and this feeling of belonging, an identity. Of course, right now, even in my own home, every other word is mom, 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 mom. I'm not offended. There's a nurture there. That's a good thing. Oh, I know that she's the favored one. I just simply do my job, though, and eventually my children come to find there's a security when our authority is here and is present and is protecting us. I want you to transfer that illustration somewhere higher and better, because maybe you didn't have a good earthly father. Maybe even the thought of that, you think, well, we're still a failing bunch. Oh, we are. But Christ, he is our protector. He's our king. He's our authority. And you've been transferred now under that. So Satan can't get you. He can't pull you back. They can't, him and his demons, kind of sneak back into your life and pull you back over and steal you from God. You have gone from thriving in a kingdom of darkness and as a slave to sin and loving it to thriving under faithful authority, Christ. He has transferred you into his kingdom. You are bought, and there is no going back. And next, you are redeemed. You're redeemed. He says, in whom? We have redemption. There's kind of the flow of being bought back. That's what the word means. It means to buy back, to be purchased. He owns you. And the word has a correlation with our English word, emancipation. And so there's this idea of being liberated from slavery, liberated from what owned you before. We would sing that chains have been broken or that we've been set free. That's from the Bible. That's from the concept of redemption. And it's fitting because we owed a debt. We were in debt because of our sin, slaves to our sin, slaves to darkness, and Christ came and redeemed. And the words, he is risen, are essentially the stamp, if you will, on the receipt that the purchase was good. You weren't bought by a dead man who stayed dead. You were bought by a living God who went into the grave to pay your debt, took the wrath of God upon himself, and then rose from the grave to prove that he had paid it all. And so he has authority then to give life. Why? Because he is the source of life. He has the authority to enable you to live again after death because he's conquered death. You've been redeemed. By what? By his precious blood. And what is he doing even now? He parades you around. That's what the church does. Ephesians chapter 3 says, we're the manifold wisdom of God. We're on display to all authorities, principalities, rulers. You know what God's doing through your life as a believer? And Easter is another moment where that is put on display even louder, as it's the number one attended day in the professing church across the world. God is showing off. First and foremost, his son, what he did. And secondarily, but not unimportant, you. The believer. You are a trophy unto God's glory. You are a show-off mechanism that reminds the devil he could not hold you and he could not have you. Christ has bought you. You've been redeemed. And finally, number four, forgiven. You are forgiven because he has risen. This is why we praise him. And I don't know about you. I hope so. I'm sure for many of you as believers, you are aware of what your sin would mean if it weren't for Christ. Amen? I don't know, maybe you're a person here and you feel guilty all the time, though. I talk to Christians who go through this, and maybe you're a non-Christian who goes through this, or you feel guilty all the time. You're weighed down by feelings of not being good enough, even coming into church. I remember inviting a friend of mine to church not long ago, and he said, how do you like your roof staying intact at the church? I said, come on, here we go. And he goes, no, I'm telling you, that roof will cave in if I show up. I said, brother, I've been there a while now. It ain't fallen yet, so I think you're good. I know my sin. I know the way I was. I take you further. You want to meet? I can introduce you to some people that, worse than both of us put together, that are thriving in our church, that Jesus has saved. I know some ex-convicts. You want some ex-thieves? You want some people who have walked a road of destruction and seen the Lord forgive them? Oh, you got nothing on them. In fact, you think too highly of your sin. When you place your faith in Christ, you are forgiven. This is the essence of the cross. Some of you get so caught up on being good enough and holy enough, and yet you love Him. You want to obey Him. You want to follow after Him. And you got kind of that spiritual dysphoria, like sadly people who suffer from anorexia, they look in the mirror and they're never skinny enough, and they wither away unto death and disease because they're looking and they're not there yet. Some of us are like that spiritually. You look in the mirror and you're constantly saying, oh, I'm almost there. I'm almost good enough for God. I've almost paid it all off. People today, I was listening to this guy talk recently to this woman. They were talking about the dangers in even the fitness industry today, and they were both in great shape and very much healthy, and they both kind of said the same thing. One of the biggest factors today in depression within the fitness industry, even people that are getting all their endorphins all day long staring at themselves, and I don't go to a gym for this reason among some others, but whatever people are doing now where they put their cell phone there and do their sets. I'm young enough to kind of know that world, but I'm old enough to go, what in the world is wrong with you people? I was an athlete too. Many of you were. No one put their cell phone down. It was like, let me get the right angle here and then use the filter and post it on Instagram. Like, get your workout done and go home. You have things to do. And they were talking about how people are so obsessed with looking a certain way, and they've got this dysphoria. I mean, they could be shredded, and you go, wow, you look amazing. And they go, yeah, not really there yet. And they're looking in the mirror, and they look like someone took a chisel and made a statue out of them. And they're going, it's just not there yet. And I'm going, man, if I could just lose 5 after Thanksgiving, I feel like a male model. I mean, these people, you and I, we get like that spiritually, guys, where you're constantly chasing some veneer of perfection instead of looking at what Christ has done and saying, I am forgiven. I don't need to wash myself. I don't need to save myself. What is happening in the moment of that kind of dysphoria is you're forgetting who you are because you're forgetting who He is. So you go back to Christ. Why do you think in Psalm 103, the psalmist explodes? Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. This is praise, and you're going to know why. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Who what? Forgives all your iniquity. He's forgiven you. You bless the Lord. You praise Him. You sing. You rejoice. Why? Because He's healed all your diseases, redeemed your life from the pit. There's a dose of reality. If you're not yet aware of where you were and who you are without Him, He redeemed your life from the pit. He crowns you with steadfast love and mercy. He satisfies you with good so that your mouth is renewed, your youth rather, and maybe your mouth if you were a little foul like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known His way to Moses, His acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious. He's slow to anger. You know that's why you've been saved. Oh, if He was quick to it, you would have been done. I would have been done. He doesn't deal with us according to our sins. Amen? He is risen. Nor repay us according to our iniquities. No, He paid for it. For as high as the heavens, look at it there, are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. Stop pursuing perfection and trying to make yourself forgivable. Just fear the Lord. Just look at him in awe because what he's done. He's not going to be angry with you forever. He removes our transgressions. How far? Just a little bit further than where you are? No. He is risen means that those sins have been paid for, washed, cleansed, and removed from you as far as the east is from the west. And I got great news for you. Either way, the world is massive, but if you're a flat earther this morning, that could be an even greater distance potentially. Come on, church. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. Would you just fear the Lord? Would you just be in awe of who he is? Would you just worship him because of what he's done? It's all about him. So you are, yes, all of those things, but why? Because of who he is. And I want you to remember that if you are a believer, you've got a hope that is alive. And if you're someone here and you'd say, I don't have hope, hope can be yours and never taken from you because Christ is alive. That's where Paul goes first. But then if you were to view this as sort of we just hit cruising altitude, we've been up there for a little while, and now you feel that little drop in your stomach as the captain comes on and says, we're now going to begin our descent. I want you to see where he lands here. And it's even more powerful than who you are. It is what Christ is. Because look, if you want to encourage people for a moment, focus on them. And that's great. I hope that you feel encouraged. But if you want the encouragement to last, focus on Christ. That's the best. And so, second, Christ is, look at it there first, the perfect image of God. Verse 14, he is the image of the invisible God. What does Paul want to do to encourage these Christians that are a little unstable and a little bit on shaky ground because of what's being said and what's happening in the world around them? He points them to the perfect image of God, which is the deity of Christ. The word that he uses is icon, meaning statue, resemblance. Jesus isn't like a lesser version, sort of the B-team version, or this like, you know, second in command, if you will, where he's lower than God and sort of like a Hercules maybe who's in the middle, or the Achilles, you know, is like he got dipped in the supernatural, but his heel is kind of a little vulnerable. No, he is fully God, the image of the invisible God. The idea being that if you look at Christ, you see God. And so we look to Christ. And is God dead? No, he's alive. How do you know? Because Christ is alive. He is risen. As Hebrews 1:3 says, he's the radiance of God's glory. No man can ever be described that way unless he is the Son of God. That's who Jesus is and why we believe in him above every other claim to the divine. And second, he's the preeminent creator of the world. All of these are wonderful, but this one kind of fires me up. And I don't know, maybe just because as a Christian right now, I don't always like the way the world is going. But when I think that my Savior, my Lord, he's the preeminent creator of the world, he wakes up, and unlike us, he's not checking the market to see if all of your investments are green and not red, if you have one of those apps. He's not looking at the news going, uh-oh, what did Biden do today? What's the Republican Party arguing about? And what's CNN saying? And, oh, your anxiety's going before you even had a chance to have your coffee. Imagine what happens when caffeine gets in your bloodstream and you're off to the races. He's the preeminent creator of the world. He holds it all. I believe that we should put faith in Christ just because of who he is. I do. Because he died, because he's God, because of what the Bible says. So I'm all about because I said so kind of theology. Because God said it, okay. But if I had to appeal to logic, I would literally ask somebody, do you want a God who is sort of trying to make it all work? Do you want a God who says, you got to go find yourself and do some yoga stretches and meditate and look within? Look, I don't know about you. I just don't want to look within. I have not a good thing. Just based on pure awareness of the world, I want a God who holds it all. I want to be under the one who's over it all. And that's where Paul goes. Revelation 1:5 calls Jesus the firstborn of the dead. Paul says he's the firstborn of all creation. By him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Some religions see that little phrase, firstborn, and they go, oh, look, he's one of the created beings. You could be a god too. No. What the Bible is saying when it describes Jesus as the firstborn is similar to Revelation 1:5, firstborn of the dead. Whenever you see that phrase, what he's saying is that he is in rank first, creator over all, came as a man, but the greatest of all men. Rose from the dead. You know that other people were raised from the dead too, Lazarus, but he's better than Lazarus. Elijah, dead bones came to life because of Elijah. Better. Now, there were even those who ascended. Speaking of Elijah, he goes up in a chariot of fire. Elisha, his little protege, with his double portion, kind of watches him go. Okay. Wow. No, not wow. Like Jesus, when in Acts chapter 1, he goes up. Because Jesus is the only one whose death meant redemption. The words he has risen is not so much a news update as it is a statement of authority. That his death and resurrection means that he's over all things. None of them in their resurrections conquered the power of hell. None of them hold the world and sustain it. None of them could say, like Jesus, when he told the Jews in John 8:58, before Abraham was, I am. He's always been. Put your faith in the God above all lowercase g gods. The man who came and still is above every other man. The one who rose and whose resurrection actually matters for you. And when your faith is in Christ, you don't serve a dead God. You serve a living God. You don't serve a God who died and stayed in the grave. You don't serve a God who made creation and, like that old infomercial, set it and forget it. And now he's hoping on the other end to kind of clean some stuff up. No, he is the God who is in complete control. You serve a God who is master over everything and everyone and every outcome, including the church. And so next Paul says that he is positioned over the church. He's not just preeminent creator of the world. He's positioned over the church. Verse 18, he's also head of the body, the church. He's the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. There it is. So that he himself will come to have first place in everything. Is he first in your life? Is he the be-all and the end-all of every single area of your life? Every new day, every new thing, every new position, every new thought, every new ambition, all of it. Does it all come under the firstness, if you will, of Christ and the priority of him? He is the head of the church. I drive by this temple, massive temple off of Greenfield in Gilbert, and every time I see the angel Moroni atop this temple, just a giant gold angel, the one who was said to have appeared to Joseph Smith and told him God wants you to restore and reestablish the church again. I'm always kind of smirking one side of my mouth and just sort of fired up to go evangelize Mormon friends because I'm looking thinking, who are you? Nice building. Not against building one like that. A little out of our price range for the building campaign, but who knows? Who are you? You're up there. You're higher than all of Gilbert. Pretty much the highest structure. You're looking over everything and you are looking over nothing. My God is the head of the church. I think about, you know, watching the news, and every year I'm listening to the Pope shift his views to accommodate growing pressure from the LGBTQ community. And Catholics say that the Pope, he speaks ex cathedra. His authority is on par with God when he is operating in his office as the so-called head of the church. I hear that stuff, I read that stuff, and I think, ha! You're not head of the church. You never died for anyone. Peter, your first pope, never died for anyone. He didn't die for me. I'm not looking at him as you're going to sprinkle me with your blood. No, the Bible says that Christ sprinkled the nations. He is the head. He's the one I'm going with. And on and on and on you could go. And I'm not trying to pick on every religion and turn this into kind of a mudsling fest. I'm just simply saying, do you know what all these religions miss? That their prophets aren't the head of the church, that their little angels aren't the head of the church, that their pope in his little white uniform, and there'll be another one in another white uniform. None of them are the head of the church. The Bible says that Christ is the head of the church. That's not my words. That's not a religious fight that's simply saying what the Bible says, I'm going to bet my life on. He's our provider. He's our authority. He's our protector. He's our redeemer. He's our first, and he is our King, and I pray that is what you find today if you don't have it. I want you to have confidence that the one you serve is the one who is over all. And finally, Paul says, he's the propitiation for our sin. Nobody paid for your sin but Christ. And nobody could. Why? It was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him. God the Father is not pleased with any of these other figures or religions or man-made ideas. He is only pleased with his Son. And so if you want to experience the blessing of God, attach yourself to his Son. Having what? Look at it there. Through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of the cross. I want to invite you today, if you've never laid your life down and surrendered it to Christ, that you would. I want to ask you to consider your soul. I want to ask you to consider the question, do I have lasting peace? Do I have a security and an assurance that my soul is secure, that I'm positioned in the kingdom of God and not the kingdom of darkness? Which domain are you under today? Whose power are you under today? For those of you that have given your life to Christ, be reminded you serve the living God. You have no need to be insecure. You have no need to wonder about the future. Those of you that are searching and you're at that fork in the road and you're wondering, is it going to be a dead end again? If you would follow Christ, that road, it'll never end. It'll go on into eternity, into his kingdom, under his rule and authority and reign and eternity upon eternity upon eternity, the infinite measure of time that your brain begins to short out when you think about all of that, yours. But even before those moments when your breaths grow shorter and eventually they end, before that peace, there's a peace you can have even now if you would give your life to Christ. And I pray that you would find, as the church in Colossae did, your assurance, your joy, and even your rest in that truth alone. We are going to sing a song to close. The song is called Behold Our God. And before I pray, I want to invite the band to come up, and they're going to lead us in that song for a few minutes. And as we sing it, I want you to reflect on the praises of Psalm 103. Why does the psalmist say, bless the Lord? Why do we sing Behold Our God? Because, church, what Christ has done for us. Because those three words, he is risen. Let me pray for us and then we'll sing to close. Our God and Father, we are not in a position to save ourselves. We're not even in a position to make an appeal on our own behalf. Because of our sin, when you just look at the world, we were and we are the problem, and your Son is the solution. We pray that today, those who have not come to find Christ as the way and the truth and the life would. And I pray for every believer in here that you would renew their heart today and their mind, that they would get their eyes off of themselves. We would all do that, me included. That you would put away a spirit of cynicism and complacency, that sort of stale Christian attitude that we can all be guilty of. What a reminder today that we exist for your purposes and your glory because of Christ, through Christ, and for Christ. That he would be all things to us. We thank you for the resurrection and that your Son is risen. We thank you and pray all of this in his name. Amen. Let's stand and sing.
Come let us adore him. Behold.
Amen. He is risen. Be blessed.